Hello, welcome to Cleft Palate Speech and Feeding video tutorials. My name is Kate Crowley and we're here at Teachers College, Columbia University in the program of Speech Language Pathology. I've created these video modules with my co-authors, Dr. Miriam Baigorri and Chelsea Sommer. Here we are in module 3.5, where we're going to look at strategies to address pharyngeal fricatives, pharyngeal stops, mid-dorsum palatal stops, and nasal rustles. So when we're going to talk about pharyngeal fricatives, we have a wonderful case study of a little six-year-old who came to us when she was five with many, many pharyngeal fricatives. Pharyngeal fricatives are typically used to substitute for the fricatives, the s, z, and sh, and sometimes the affricates like ch in chair and j in juice. But here's how you make it. Your tongue base touches the posterior pharyngeal wall, but it doesn't completely stop the airflow. Airflow can be voiced or voiceless, and it can be co-produced with a fricative or an affricate. So here it is. Basically, you've heard this in many languages. For example, Caribbean Spanish might, certain dialects of Caribbean Spanish, for perro, the trilled R, they use a pharyngeal fricative, pejo. Or for carro, the cajo. Another pharyngeal fricative, people pronounce the country Mexico, Mexico, or Oaxaca, beautiful place in Mexico. It's also very common in French, merci, German, Hebrew. Many languages have pharyngeal fricatives. General American English does not. So this is the sound. It can be voiced or voiceless. And you can produce it with an affricate. So the co-production stuff is tricky because you have to pull them both out. So that's your pharyngeal fricative. So we're going to show you the first time we worked with this little girl. We call her Peyton. And you can hear the pharyngeal fricatives, which were so common in her speech. Her speech was primarily characterized by pharyngeal fricatives and glottal stops. So we're going to show you several instances of how we worked to address these pharyngeal fricatives.
So would you tell me what happened in this story?
Look.
What happens?
Mommy went to school.
The mommy goes to school. And what happens here?
The mommy is her pat right back.
Yep. And then what happens here?
The mommy taught in the classroom.
Yes, and what are all the, how does this child feel?
Happy.
What about this one?
Happy.
Yeah.
Saturday.
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 Oh. And how about this? Not Sunday, but Sunday.
Sunday.
Beautiful.
Yes. 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 Yes.
I don't like hearing the in it. That's what I don't like hearing. I'm hearing. Yes, yes, yes. I want to hear yes, yes.
Ready?
Do you know what, can you hear the difference?
Mm-hmm.
I don't want to hear the, I don't want to hear yes.
We want
I just
want to
hear. There.
Ready? Ta.
Ta.
Te.
Te.
One more time. Te.
Te.
Remember to smile with your lips open. Te.
Te.
Good work. Ti.
Ti.
Toe.
Toe.
Toe or toe?
Toe.
Oh. Smile.
Toe.
Perfect. You did it.
Yeah. Ready?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll go first.
Yeah.
T, t, s. Woo! One more. T, t, s. Very nice.
Four. Five. Six. 7, 8, 9. You did it!
What?
Good.
Yeah.
Ready? Sa.
Sa.
Perfect.
Sa.
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 Uh-oh. I like it here.
Sa.
Chelsea?
Sa. Sa.
Sa.
Sa.
Sa.
Oh!
Clean the kitchen today?
Yes.
Nice. Is Miss B your speech therapist?
Yes.
Yes. Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Is Chelsea counting your yeses?
Yes.
Do you live in this apartment?
Yes.
Is Javi older than you?
Yes.
Is your mommy beautiful?
Yes.
Is your grandma a great cook?
Yes.
Did you take your slippers off?
Yes.
Do you want to answer another question?
Yes.
Could you please tell us, what was it like to get speech therapy from me and from Miss Chelsea?
Fun.
What made it so much fun?
The prizes.
Yes, and the prizes, right? Yeah. And what did you have to do to get good speech like you have now? What did you have to do to get there?
Practice.
Practice. And how did you practice? Yeah.
With my mom.
Uh-huh.
My grandma and Harvey.
Uh-huh. And what was the what kind of things did you practice? Because you worked up very hard on this.
The K.
Yes. Any other sounds you worked hard on?
The sleep.
Yes. And what was a favorite book? You had so many books that you worked with. What was your favorite?
Benny and the Polar book.
Benny and Penny?
Yeah.
Yeah. Why did you like that book?
Because it had my favorite words in it.
And what are your favorite words now?
All of them.
All of them.
As you can see, she responded very well, first with the single sounds. We started with the bilabial sounds, the pa and the ba, then we moved back to the ta and the da. From the ta, we went to the s. And these are all trying to move that forward. So you can watch the progress as we went from single sound to syllables to words to the storybooks and then to conversation across. And then we got to T, during the S. We're working now on the k and the g, which are the sounds that are more challenging for her. She has the F, she has the V. But a lot of those sounds, she used this pharyngeal fricative for. Now we're going to talk about two other errors, the pharyngeal stop and the mid-dorsum palatal stop. Now these are both kinds of stops, and they're generally used for the k, g, t, d, p, b, which are high-pressure stops in English. We work on place of articulation because the child already has manner. So there's the k, the stop is, this is a stop, k, g, t, d, p, b. The manner is a stop. It's not like the s or the sh or the zh. These are stops. So the manner is there, it's placement that's missing. So a pharyngeal stop is typically used to substitute for k and g. When you make the k and g, you know that your tongue goes up back against the velum. But when a child has a cleft palate, tongue going up against the velum cannot cause the high pressure sound because that child has a hole there, right? So it's not gonna work. So what some children do when they have their open cleft is they create a stop by using the back of their tongue at their pharyngeal wall. So they create the closure below the oral cavity like this. Ka, ka, ka. So I'm not making the k, g. Instead, it's hitting back here. The back of my lower part of my tongue is hitting the posterior pharyngeal wall, k, k, or kitten, or kitten, can, cookie, 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 cookie. Cookie is with the k at the velum. Cookie is at the k at the posterior pharyngeal wall. So what are the strategies to eliminate the pharyngeal stops? Well, as you can see, all we really need to do is move that sound anteriorly, right? So if it's back here and the tongue is hitting back here, cookie, cookie, then what we want to do is move the sound forward so it's at cookie, it's right at the velum. So we start with place of articulation and sound discrimination, right? It's a little hard to hear, it's a little hard to produce, but let's see. Caw, caw, that's your pharyngeal stop. K, k is your k sound at the velum, the appropriate manner, placement of voicing. So we're going to try to move that forward by having the child be able to distinguish between, is this the sound that's in the throat or in the mouth? Here we go. Caw. That's in the throat. Now it's not as far down as the glottal stops, but it's right about here. Or this, k, that's in the mouth. Caw. In the throat, k, in the mouth. Cookie. That's in the throat, cookie, that's in the mouth. So sometimes we actually over-exaggerate the placement to move it forward. So instead of saying, let's have that k, so is this k, let's see if they can make a t, move it way forward. And then sometimes the motor movements will adjust, but you gotta get it to the right place. But one way of doing it is to over-exaggerate the placement. And here is an example in Ghana of a girl using a pharyngeal stop instead of the k. We are actually able to do some great work with her and move that pharyngeal stop forward just in one session.
Good.
Yeah, no, I can see too.
Yes. So here's a couple of strategies to move that sound. One, show where the sound is produced. So you can use the picture of the profile and show here's where the k is being produced, the k, 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 versus the k, 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 k on a profile. You can also touch the soft palate with a clean spoon or tongue depressor to tickle that spot where it's supposed to be, so they can feel where it goes. And I can also make the sound with an open mouth so they can look in my mouth and see what's happening. K, k, as opposed to k, 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 as opposed to k, k. And one of the things we need to do to be really good speech therapists for cleft palate patients is to be able to make the errors. So I really do urge you as you go through these video tutorials to try to make these errors with us so that you can then use them with the patient to say, well, where is this sound for discrimination? Is it a k or is it a k?
So what is a mid-dorsum palatal stop? This is typically a substitute for the t, d, and the k, g. The production of a mid-dorsum palatal stop occurs right between the velar sound and the alveolar sound. So where the t and d are made and the k and g are made. So it's not exactly alveolar where the t and d are produced, and it's not velar where the k and g are made, rather right in the middle.
T. T. T.
Next we'll see a child producing these mid-dorsum palatal stops.
Ta.
Ta.
Okay, let's try it. Let's do ta.
Yes.
Two.
Shu.
Du.
Bu.
Do.
Do.
Di.
Di.
De.
De.
Ki, ki, ki.
Ki, ki, ki.
Ko, ko, ko.
Ko, ko, ko.
Here are some strategies to eliminate mid-dorsum palatal stops. Start with placement of articulation and sound discrimination. So where we want to move the sound depends. So if it's posterior, we want to move k and g back further to the velum. Or we may want to move the sound forward anteriorly for the t and d sound. You can use the l or n for placement of the t and d. You can use n for placement of k and g. Try having the child exaggerate where the sound is produced. So if your target is the t sound made at the alveolar ridge make them move that sound even more forward than they think. So, ta, ta. Another strategy to eliminate the mid-dorsum palatal stop is to show where the sound is actually produced. Use a schematic or a drawing to demonstrate where the sound is made. For example, use this profile illustration, which can be found on leadersproject.org. Demonstrate that the sound is being produced near the teeth for the t and d, or by the velum for the k and g, and not in the middle of the mouth where the mid-dorsum palatal stop occurs. Also, you can use a clean spoon or tongue depressor and touch the soft palate so the child feels the place of production. Make the sound with an open mouth to show how the k and g is produced, or you can show the t and d. So what is a nasal rustle? Nasal rustle can occur due to a structural defect or a misarticulation. If the nasal rustle is due to a structural defect, this occurs inconsistently on all high-pressure sensitive sounds, including the p, t, k, and it often increases with utterance length or fatigue. Nasal rustle due to misarticulation occurs consistently on certain phonemes. For example, every time the child produces the s sound, you may hear it. It is most common on sibilants, particularly the s and z. Nasal rustle is typically a substitute for high-pressure sounds, such as p, t, and k. For production of nasal rustle, instead of the typical airflow, air exiting out of the mouth, for high-pressure sounds, the air is going up to the back of the nose. The air rustles up here, creating the nasal rustle sound. So for example, if the child is trying to say key, it may sound like
ka, ka, ka.
Here's an example of a child we've been working with in New York City who uses the nasal rustle.
Oop-poo.
Oop-poo.
Wait a minute, let me hear that one again.
Oop-poo. Oop-poo.
Here are some strategies to eliminate the nasal rustle. Start with placement of articulation and sound discrimination. Again, you can do this by using the clown discrimination drawing found on leadersproject.org or the profile drawing, which is also found on leadersproject.org. Show where the nasal rustle sound is made in contrast to that of the correct production of whatever sound is being focused or targeted. Work on air coming out through the mouth rather than being trapped in the nasopharynx. Use a schematic or a drawing to demonstrate where the sound is being made. Again, when practicing these strategies at home, parental involvement is essential. You should also incorporate the parent in all therapy activities, inside of your clinic or outside of your clinic. Practice 3 times a day for at least 100 times. We have seen much success when parents are involved in therapy and when they practice at home.
So that ends module 3.5, where we looked at strategies to address 4 common compensatory errors with cleft palate speech. Remember, this and all other information is available at leadersproject.org. And also, please, parents, you are the only way we have success if you work with your children at home. Thank you.